السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على أشرف الأنبياء وسيد المرسلين نبينا ورسولنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين ثم أما بعد. So we are here today on the 6th of Dhul Hijjah, 4 days away from Eid al-Adha, 3 days away from Yawm Arafah. Sat here as normal studying from the tremendous book of Al-Imam Al-Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala in Adab and Morals, Etiquettes and Characteristics, Al-Adab Al-Mufrad. And we were discussing the Athar and Ahadith Imam Bukhari rahimahullah narrates in Babu Jaza'il Walidain, the chapter of the recompense and the repayment of the parents. And the hadith we have today, it is an example of, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Ar-Rahman, هَلْ جَزَاءُ الْإِحْسَانِ إِلَّا الْإِحْسَانِ. Is the reward, is the recompense, is the repayment of goodness anything except goodness? How is it that you can repay somebody that has been good to you with anything except another form of goodness? And it shows for us and it expresses for us the care that our parents, the parents have for their children, and how the parents, they are constantly in a state of worrying for the sake of their children, for their safety, for their well-being, from any type of evil which may touch them, any type of hardship, any type of suffering that may afflict them. And this feeling from the parents to the children is something which is natural, something which is innate to mankind. Every parent, for the most part, wants that which is good for their children. No parent, for the most part, of course you have exceptions, most parents, they always want that which is the best for their children. So this is something which is natural, as I mentioned. And our deen, Islam, for those things which come to us naturally, things which come naturally, but they are conducive, they lead us toward Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those things our deen has came to solidify and to make them more concrete, to encourage us even more in those things which are good, which are conducive, which have an overwhelming good to them. And that come naturally. Like, for example, what do I mean by this? I mean, if I give an example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in Surah Ali Imran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, الَّذِينَ يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهَ قِيَامًا وَقُعُودًا وَعَلَى جُنُوبِهِمْ وَيَتَفَكَّرُونَ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions a specific type of ibadah, of worship, which is ibadah of the inside of a person, the intrinsic of a person. And that is, after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that those who they worship Allah, they mention Allah while standing, while sitting, while lying on their side, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَيَتَفَكَّرُونَ. They think and they ponder and they reflect, فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ, in the creation of the heavens and the earth. This aspect of worship, of pondering upon the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is something which is natural to mankind. This is something which all of us, we experience at one time, at one point in our life or another. Every single human being will go through the same thought process, where they will sit down and they will ponder and they will think on the creation we have around us. We will think and we'll reflect on the greenness of the grass, how perfect is the sky, the mountains and the rivers, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created everything in such concordance, in such perfection with each other, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created everything in unison with each other, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the khalq, created the creation in such a beautiful creation. This is something which will come naturally to humankind, to think and to ponder around the surroundings we have, the natural beauty we find ourselves around it. This is something innate to us. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made this an act of worship. Why? Because this is such an act which leads us to worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which leads us to gain nearness to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَيَتَفَكَّرُونَ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. And then what's the outcome? رَبَّنَا مَا خَلَقْتَ هَذَا بَاطِلًا سُبْحَانَكَ فَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. Oh our Lord, You have not created all of this in jest. You have not created all of this for no purpose. Rather, O Allah, You have created all this creation, this beauty that we see around us, of the natural world, of the mountains, of the day and the night. All of this in perfect unison with each other. O Allah, You have created this for a purpose. You have not created this without any purpose. So this is something natural to mankind, which our deen comes and pushes it. Our deen comes and gives it an aspect of religiosity to it. Our deen channels it to get us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So as I was mentioning, that this feeling which parents they have toward their children and children have toward their parents, this natural feeling, is something innate to us, something each human being possesses for the most part. Each human being possesses this. But our deen has come and channeled it in such a way that it becomes an act of worship. It becomes pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of the conducive good that comes out of it. That it joins the ties of kinship. It strengthens the society. It strengthens the relationships families have with each other. Hence why our deen has come and put a positive light and put a religious aspect to these natural feelings that we have as human beings. So this hadith I was saying today, mukhtasar, this short lesson we're going to have today, because of course we're in the days of Dhul Hijjah, there are many other acts of worship we could be doing, reciting the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so many other ibadah we could be doing, hence why we'll have a little mukhtasar lesson today. So I was saying that this hadith, it gives us an example from the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, how this natural feeling of the parents caring for the children, and children sometimes not reciprocating that feeling back, how our deen has channeled it in such a way. Okay, so Imam Bukhari rahmahullah, will go into the hadith. Imam Bukhari says, حَدَّثَنَا أَبُو نُعَيْم الْفَضْلُ بْنُ الدَّكَيْنَ التَّيْمِي رَحْمَهُ تعالى. We took his biography a bit about from his tarjama in some previous lessons. Al-Imam Al-Hafiz, Shaykh Al-Islam, فَضْلُ بْنُ الدَّكَيْنَ أَبُو نُعَيْم التَّيْمِي رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ تعالى. قال حدثنا سفيان. He said, narrated to us سفيان بن سعيد الثوري رحمه الله تعالى. Regarding Imam Sufyan al-Thawri, Imam Abdullah ibn al-Mubarak رحمه الله تعالى, from the أمراء المؤمنين في الحديث, that legend Imam Abdullah ibn al-Mubarak رحمه الله, he said, Imam Sufyan al-Thawri, he is مجمع على إمامته مع الإتقان والضبط والحفظ والمعرفة والزهد والورع. He can't get a greater praise than this. Imam Abdullah ibn al-Mubarak rahmahullah, he said that Imam Sufyan al-Thawri, he is agreed upon, mujma'un ala imamati, he is agreed upon his leadership. Him being an imam, this is something nobody has any dispute about. It is agreed upon, his imamship, with his perfection, his precision, his memorization, his knowledge of hadith, his zuhd and his wara', his asceticism and his extra religiosity. So Imam Abu Nu'aym al-Fadl ibn Dukayn writes from Imam Sufyan al-Thawri, from Ata' ibn al-Sa'ib. Ata' ibn al-Sa'ib, imamun thiqa. Al-Imam Ata' ibn al-Sa'ib rahmahullah ta'ala, he is one of those ruwat of hadith who in the earlier part of his life, those who they narrated to him, from him, their narrations are correct, their narrations are trustworthy. But those who narrate from him in his elder age, their narrations are muddarab, their narrations are considered as being contradictory, because in his later part of his life, his memory lapsed a little bit. So Imam Sufyan al-Thawri rahmahullah narrated from him from his earlier part of his age. Imam Ata ibn al-Sa'ib rahmahullah ta'ala, from his father, who is also thiqa, from Abdullah ibn Amr radiallahu ta'ala anhuma. And in Ad-Durr al-Manthur of Al-Imam Jalaluddin Abdul Rahman al-Suyuti rahmahullah ta'ala, a book of tafsir, the same narration is mentioned, but the rawi is Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhuma. But the sawab and the correct is Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-Aas radiallahu ta'ala anhuma. He is a sahabi, his father is likewise a sahabi. And he was one interesting point of his life, radiallahu ta'ala an, is as we mentioned previously, there was only a short amount of time of there was a small amount of time, yes, between him and his father. He was 12 years younger than his father, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Imagine, he was 12. There was 12 years between him, you know, and his siblings, him and his father, which goes to show that back in the Arabian Peninsula, in that time, 1,000 years ago, people used to marry at a younger age. So hence why, I don't know why people online, especially so many critics of Islam, they have problems with the age of a Sayyida Aisha Siddiqa radiallahu ta'ala anha being married to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam at a young age. When we have the similitude like this, like Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anhu, he was born to his father when his father was 12 years old. So this was something common during the time that people, they married younger. And what is the biggest evidence of this is that none of the enemies of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they brought this as a criticism of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he married Sayyida Aisha radiallahu anha at a young age. So Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, he said that jaa rajulun ila an-nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a man, he came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, yubayi'uhu ala al-hijra, seeking to pledge to him the pledge of allegiance upon migration. So migration, hijra, occurred in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam three times. The first was when the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in, they made hijra from Makkah al-Mukarrama to Al-Habasha. And that was from a land of kufr to a land of kufr. From Makkah, which was a land of idolatry, to Habasha, which was a predominantly Christian land. But the reason that they were allowed and they were commanded to make hijra there is because the Malik, the king, he was a just and he was a person who was fair and just. So they made hijra to Al-Habasha. Then they came back due to some rumors that had emerged that the Quraysh had become Muslim. And that was because of some ayat in Surah An-Najm. So when they came back, that was the first hijra. Then the second hijra is when they went again to Al-Habasha. They migrated again to Abyssinia, to Ethiopia. And then they came back to Medina when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Sahaba were at Khaybar. And then the other hijra is when the rest of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'in, they made hijra from Mecca or from the various places in Arabia to Al-Madinatul Munawwara. So this was the three stages that hijra happened. So at one of these points, most probably the last point, when the Prophet was in Medina, a man, he approached the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from a far off land. He came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, yubayi'uhu ala al-hijra, giving him the wanting to pledge allegiance to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam upon migration, that ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I have migrated to you, I have made hijra to you. And such a great action this is of making hijra. Al-hijratu tahdimu ma kana qablaha. Hijra, when a person makes hijra, this destroys whatever was preceded in terms of sins. Whatever sins had done before, they had been demolished. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala erased them. Al-hijratu tahdimu ma kana qablaha. So to consolidate this, he wanted to give bay'ah to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He wanted to pledge his allegiance to him alayhi salatu wa sallam. And he said, وَتَرَكَ أَبَوَيْهِ يَبْكِيَانِ. But what was one defect he had? He left his parents back, wherever he was from, the place is not mentioned. He left his parents, he abandoned his parents while they were يَبْكِيَانِ, while they were weeping, while they were crying. Meaning they did not want him to leave. They did not want to leave him and to go far off to the land of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. وَتَرَكَ أَبَوَيْهِ يَبْكِيَانِ. He left his parents while they were weeping, while they were in a state of huzn, while they were in a state of sadness. They were in a state of, they did not want him to leave them. And when we ponder on this a little bit, some of the scholars, they say that when a person leaves their parents, they should, as much as they're able, try to go back to them. Try to go back to them. Why? Because they say, Sayyidina Yaqub alayhi salatu wassalam, he had 12 sons, but it was Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam who his his being away from him made him weep, made him cry, made him lose his eyesight, alayhi salatu wassalam. So perhaps you may be the Yusuf of your parents, you know? Sayyidina Yaqub alayhi salatu wassalam, he had 11 other sons, but none of them could be the same as Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam. It's because of him that Sayyidina Yaqub alayhi salatu wassalam, he lost his eyesight and he was in a state of sadness and a state of huzn because of him alayhi salatu wassalam, not because of any of the other sons. So perhaps you may be the Yusuf of your parents. Yes, you say, I have other siblings, I have so many brothers and sisters. Yes, but the same, if you apply that to Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam, he had many brothers also, sisters, Allahu A'lam, but he had many brothers also, but he was the Yusuf of the eyes of his father alayhi as-salatu wassalam. So he left his parents while they were crying, meaning they did not want him to leave them. Faqal, so the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, instructing him, he said, irji' ilayhima wa adhikhuma kama abkaytahuma. He did not accept the bay'ah of this person. He did not accept the pledge of allegiance of this person. Rather, he said, go back to them. Return back to both of your parents. وَأَضْحِكْهُمَا كَمَا أَبْكَيْتَهُمَا. And make them laugh. Make them smile. Make them happy. Make them joyful. The same way you abandoned them and you made them weep and you made them cry. Up until you do this, your pledge and your bay'ah of hijrah will be unaccepted by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Which goes to show another thing also. Which goes to show that even hijrah, even in some riwayat it comes jihad. Even jihad fi sabilillah or hijrah fi sabilillah, it is unaccepted without the permission of the parents. How many people, how many young men and women in the UK, in Europe, in America perhaps, in other places of the world, how many young men and women, they were fooled and they were duped into this Daesh, this ISIS, to make hijrah to them, to go and fight jihad fi sabilillah with them, which is not jihad, it's fitna and it's fasad, it is corruption and it is tribulation. How many young people, and it's always young people, because young people, they are naive. You know, حُدَثَاء الْأَسْنَانِ سُفَهَاء الْأَحْلَامِ, as the Prophet ﷺ described, that the young people, they will be حُدَثَاء الْأَسْنَانِ, young in age, and they are سُفَهَاء الْأَحْلَامِ. They are crazy in the ideas, they have crazy ideas, a utopia in their mind, that when they reach such and such a place, then they will do X, Y, and Z, things which the elder people in society, they will know it is nonsense, it is garbage, it will never ever happen, because they have the experience of life. So how many young people, young men and young women from our communities perhaps, they were duped and they were fooled into going to Iraq and Sham to be with this frivolous group, to be with this fringe organization, this terrorist organization, and they left their parents yabkiyan. They left their parents crying and weeping, wanting them not to go and to throw their lives away. How many of that happened? If only they understood, if only they studied and they knew that without the permission of their parents, their hijrah or their so-called hijrah or their so-called jihad would be unacceptable in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It would have no weight to it in the scales with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Prophet, he said here, irji' ilayhima wa adhikhuma kama abkaytahuma, meaning it has no value, your hijrah or your jihad, if it is done without the consent and without the permission of the parents. Go back to them, return back to them, and make them smile, make them laugh, make them happy, make them joyful, the same way you did what you did to them when you made them cry and you made them weep because of your leaving and abandoning them. The same way, make them happy, make them cry. هل جزاء الإحسان إلا الإحسان. We go back. هل جزاء الإحسان إلا الإحسان. Is the reward of goodness except anything of goodness? The way that they brought you up, the way that they gave you nourishment when you were younger, the way they nurtured you when you were younger, the jaza of that is nothing except ihsan, except that you go back to them and you make them happy, you make them laugh. The same way you made them cry, هَلْ جَزَاءُ الْإِحْسَانِ إِلَّا الْإِحْسَانِ. So we learn from this that the jaza of the walidain, because this is the chapter Imam Bukhari rahmatullah brings in, the babu jaza il walidain, is for them to remain, is for us to remain in a state of making them happy and making them joyful, making them smile and making them laugh. This is the recompense of our parents in this life. As I mentioned previously, the true and the actual jaza, the haqiqi, the true reward of the parents will be in the akhirah. That can never be personified in this life. That can never be actualized in this hayat al-dunya. Their true reward for their hardships they undertook while bringing up their children will be in the akhirah with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But in this life, in this dunya, the reward for our parents as much as possible is for us to remain in their servitude, to make them happy and to make them joyful the same way that they made us happy and us joyful while we were younger. Irji' ilayhima wa adhikhuma kama abkaytuma. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam, irregardless how lofty the niyyah of this person was, how great the intention of this person was to make hijrah to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, to go and live in al-Madinatul Munawwara, to surround himself with the Sahabatul Kiram alayhim ar-Ridwan, to accompany himself with those who are the best of people. Imagine praying behind the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, praying Fajr, Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib, Isha behind him alayhi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, listening to his khutab, listening to his mawa'idh, listening to his reminders alayhi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, being there with him. What a lofty goal that is, which we have been deprived of coming 1400 years after him alayhi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But this individual, he was there at the time. And he wanted to surround himself with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and great company, righteous, pious company of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'in. But yet, without the acknowledgement of his parents, without the permission and the consent of his parents, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Go back to them. It is unacceptable by me. Go back to them and make them happy and make them joyful the same way you have made them cry and you have made them weep." We'll stop here for today, inshallah ta'ala. Jazakumullahu khairan. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.